Yeah.
There we go. Okay, well, welcome everybody. We're here today to talk about the utility rates study that we've been undergoing for several months now, and to hear back from our team, both staff and the StanTech consultant team, as to the findings. My name's Laura Kifas, and I'll be hosting today. We will ask you to hold all your questions till the end. Our presentation today should be about 20 minutes or so, so we'll have plenty of time. Okay, I'm going to turn it over to Andy at StanTech.
Very good. And actually, Tara, I don't know if you wanted to just mention just a couple of things up front to kind of give an overview before we dive into some of the detail, perhaps.
Thank you, Andy. Yes. So I'm Tara Ford. I'm the Municipal Utilities Director. And Andrew Burnham, he's the Vice President of StanTech Consulting and Management Technologies. And StanTech did a very robust rate study this year. They've done several of ours in the past. And so with that, though, there's a lot of data behind this. But like Laura said, this presentation will be approximately 10 to 15 minutes. There'll be plenty of time for questions if anybody has any or any comments. A few things I wanted to point out in this rate study from past rate studies, we have some changes. One of the major changes is moving from a five-tier structure to a four-tier structure, which Andy will talk in detail about. We also conducted a strength and loading study this year, which means the amount of loading that goes into the wastewater side of it. So we were able to get accurate data of what is actually going into the collection system, and we can bill our customer classifications appropriately. In the past, we utilized industry standards, best practice, and Andy will talk about that as well. We also reviewed the flood irrigation program, and this year's rate study, there was a focus on conservation as well. We will also be recommissioning our Kyrene Water Reclamation Facility, and that it has a big component of conservation, the reason that we're bringing that wastewater treatment plant back online. So that is factored into the wastewater rates as well. And we also, this year, we have a stormwater fee that will be a part of the bill. And I want to point out that is not an additional fee. Those were already factored in before into your rates. Now they are just pulled out and a separate fee on there, which again, Andy will talk about. So with that, I would like to turn it over to Andy and he can start the presentation. Thank you.
Sure. Thank you, Tara. So first starting just with a little bit of an overview on the approach. So consistent with past utility rate studies within the city, we've endeavored to make sure that we have proportional cost allocations really at the heart of the specific rate recommendations for both water as well as the wastewater rate structures. And the ways that we're able to get there is by leveraging a lot of the city's high degree of data that's available. It's uniquely available for utility systems to have advanced metering infrastructure that gives us daily and hourly information about customer usage characteristics that contribute to our cost. And now we also have a strength and sampling study for the wastewater side that does give us some information and intelligence about how customers' water is returning to the wastewater system and what's the characteristics of that wastewater in terms of how much pollutant loading does it have in it for various types of customer classifications. Consistent with past endeavors, the city has really tried to have proactive communications involvement at the beginning of the study, as well as during and at the conclusion where we're preparing initial findings and recommendations. To make sure that the community has an opportunity to review and weigh in. And as mentioned earlier by Tara, you know, this year's study did focus on a couple of specific programs to make sure that we're focused on how we cover the cost of those programs today and how that might look in the future. And this relates to really stormwater and environmental activities, as well as the flood irrigation program. So for those of you that haven't been involved in a rate study process in the past, whether it's within the city of Tempe or another community, that's really fundamentally answering three interconnected questions. How much revenue is required to cover the operating and capital cost needs of the utility system? That's the revenue requirements item identified here. And once we've identified how much revenue is required to meet those cost requirements, the next question is, how should we allocate those amongst our different types of customers, residents and businesses within the community? And once we've defined how we should achieve that cost allocation based upon available data in terms of usage as well as service characteristics, we then need to say, well, how do we charge for those costs? What combination of fixed monthly service charges as well as variable rate structure should we have in the community that captures those costs and recovers them from each of the individual residences and business owners within the community? And once we've done that analysis and answered and looked at those three interrelated questions, we then want to make sure we've got a very good understanding of the impacts of any potential changes to the rates that may come from that analysis. And again, throughout the process, communicating actively with stakeholders at the beginning, middle, and end of the process to make sure we're all on the same page relative to what we're seeing. So from a fundamental perspective relative to revenue requirements, what the study has found is that the current resources within the water as well as wastewater systems in the city aren't sufficient to meet their ongoing expenditure requirements for operations and maintenance as well as capital. And so we've identified a needed increase in revenues for fiscal year 2023, which is the fiscal year we're in now, of 5.5% for the water system and 2.5% for the wastewater or the sewer system. Embodied within those two is establishing a separate stormwater or environmental fee of $3 per month per account. And I'll go into more details on the specific program activities that are embodied in that $3 fee. But again, as Tara mentioned, these are for costs that are within the existing utility system, and we're really just calling them out separately as part of these recommendations. And then additionally, we'll talk a little bit about flood irrigation, and we have reiterated a plan of increases to achieve a 50% cost recovery in the program, and we'll go into more depth about what that specifically looks like for those customers that may have flood irrigation. But even with these requirements in mind, the next step really builds on these two book pictures at the bottom of the slide. You know, once we've understood how much revenue is required, we really need to look very carefully at how we should allocate those requirements to the various types of customers within the community. And so for the water system, we follow the American Water Works Association rate-making manuals. As an industry group, they publish principles, practices, and methodologies for allocating costs to customers based upon their demand characteristics as well as service characteristics. And so you can see the results of a rather detailed process and data analysis here on this slide that shows the current revenues provided by the existing rates on the water side versus what the cost of service indicates based upon the most current information about customer demand and service characteristics. And so while the system overall needs a 5.5% increase in revenues, the distribution of the total cost of service between each of the customer classifications varies based upon their updated information and their demands that are contributing to the cost requirements on the system. So you can see that single family customers have about a 6.1% overall increase in revenue required versus the current rate structure, whereas multifamily is looking at about a 15.1% increase. And you can see these increases vary, and they do vary from study to study as customer demand characteristics and usage profiles change, and as the complexion of our community changes, and we have greater concentrations perhaps of more multifamily accounts and more usage on the system than what we did in the past. So once we've established the amount of revenue to be recovered from each of these customer types, if you will, we then looked at developing updated monthly service charges as well as updated variable rates. And as you'll see on this chart here, the fixed monthly service charge schedule is based on meter size. For most residential customers within the community, you'll have a 5/8, a 3/4 inch, or a 1 inch meter size. As part of the study, we look carefully at how much of our cost requirements do we want to collect in our fixed monthly service charges versus variable rates. And we adjusted that percentage to capture slightly more revenue in our variable rates that are based on metered water use. So this helps promote affordability for low volume use, but also continues to provide a price incentive for those that are using more water by recovering more cost in those variable rates. So as you look at the schedule, you'll see reductions in every single fixed monthly service charge by meter size. The dollar amounts vary depending upon the updated average use by meter size, but all see a reduction in that monthly service charge with these proposed rate recommendations. Now, as it relates to the single family rate structure, as Tara mentioned, we're looking at for this year a 4-tier system as compared to the current 5-tier system in place today. We looked at data distribution of usage within the community and found that actually that median use or that 50th percentile is at about 8,000 gallons. And that's also consistent with indoor usage allowances for even mid and larger size families. And then we then looked at the tier two and tier three based upon a typical as well as larger lot size within the community. A couple of years ago, a detailed sampling analysis was conducted using GIS information to understand how much of these properties are generally irrigable area and what are the irrigation needs for that amount of irrigation area to determine how much water use would be appropriate for outdoor irrigation for those typical as well as a larger size lot as shown here on the screen. In relation to the existing structure today, this represents a bit of a change. We're going from the five tiers that you see here on the left to the four tier system on the right. Of note, tier one has been expanded now. Instead of being for just 6,000 gallons, it's up to 8,000 gallons. So we have more use at that lowest tier rate. And then tiers two and three now are for that irrigation allowance for tier two and tier three. And then everything above that is in tier four. So we've looked at really trying to make sure we're taking into account current usage characteristics in addition to current cost as part of establishing our tiers. Now, I mentioned these tier sizings are based on general usage profiles. It's certainly possible that individual customers' usage will vary, and you may actually even be able to do some irrigation within tier one if you're a smaller household. We generally establish these profiles and data analysis around your information as well as industry profiles for typical customer use. So we certainly expect that there will be some variances to what I just mentioned in terms of the tiers and how they were established, but that's generally the rationale behind that tier structure, is that type of a profile analysis that's consistent with the city's data. Now, as it relates to other customer classifications in the city, we looked at the current existing rate structure, which is a rate per 1,000 gallons based upon the cost of service. And with the updated fixed monthly service charges, which are a little bit lower, and the cost allocations, you'll see here that multifamily, commercial, industrial, landscaping, construction meters, the proposed rate per 1,000 gallons is higher than what it is today, consistent with that needed increase in overall revenue, but also the fact that we did also shift a little bit of revenue recovery from those fixed monthly service charges to our usage rates as part of these recommendations. Now, as Tara mentioned, the strength and loading study that was conducted provided us for the first time in a number of years some localized data about wastewater flow and the characteristics of that flow within the community. It's been several years since a wastewater rate adjustment has occurred. In fact, I believe the last one was in 2016. And so it's been a substantial number of years since really we've looked at these types of cost allocations as a community for the wastewater system in the context of a rate study. And so it's not surprising to see some changes as part of the update process this year when we're able to now take that information about the characteristics of the wastewater flow within the community and use that to allocate the costs that we're incurring to make sure we have that proportional equity in mind. And so you'll see here for that overall 2.5% increase in revenue that was mentioned, the distribution between the different customer classifications, that would be consistent with our updated information about the amount of flow, as well as the characteristics of that flow that we have from that return flow sampling study. And again, these guideposts really help us establish then updates to the rate structure. Consistent with the water system, there is a recommendation to also reduce the wastewater fixed monthly charges to again enhance affordability as part of the process, and to place slightly more cost recovery into the variable rates based upon the billed wastewater volumes. So again, as you look at the 5/8, 3/4 inch and 1 inch meter sizes, you'll see again reductions in that proposed fixed monthly service charge across the board for all the different meter sizes. As it relates to the variable rates, these were then calculated based upon each individual customer classification's remaining revenue requirements that weren't captured in those fixed monthly charges. So you'll see the single family and multifamily rates are now going from $1.84 to $2.12 and $2.39 respectively, based upon the updated cost of service analysis and information that we have. And then you'll notice for commercial classifications, we currently have about six different categories, but based upon the strength and return flow study, we saw the opportunity based on similarities in the strength of the wastewater from customers to group them into two classifications instead of six. And so now you'll see a commercial low and a commercial high rate for each of those respective customer classes. And then for industrial customers, the cost of service study has now allowed us to be able to calculate very specifically, what is our cost per 1,000 gallons for flow-related cost, for per pound for total suspended solids, as well as for chemical oxygen demand for the organic matter that's in the wastewater. So we can charge each of those measured customers based upon their individual flow and suspended solids and organic material loadings. So all of this is great, but what does this really mean? So we've prepared a few different customer impact calculations here in this presentation that really look at it from that total utility bill perspective. When we take the services on the utility bill, water, wastewater, stormwater, solid waste, and look at, you know, for different types of customers, maybe a customer at that 50th percentile using 8,000 gallons of water with 5,600 gallons being billed for wastewater, we can see the total change in the bill going from $81.69 to $84.98, about a $3.29 increase, or about 4%. We then looked at, you know, say a little bit more water use, 15,000 gallons of water with 7,500 gallons of a return flow for wastewater. And you can see there the total change in the bill is $7.66, or about 7%. And then we took a different meter size, a 1-inch meter, with 70,000 gallons of water and 12,000 gallons of billed wastewater volume. And we see there the total dollar change is about $10.51, or about 2.4%. And so all these customers will see kind of graduating increases in the dollar amount of the bill, but the individual percentages that individual customers will see will vary throughout the community. But this is intended to kind of give you a snapshot of some example bill impacts. We then took it a step further and said, well, how does this compare both the current rate structure for these three types of usage profiles, if you will, and the proposed to many other communities in the surrounding area? And so we did a bill comparison that took the current rates for other agencies that were at the time in fiscal year 22 and compared them to what we have in Tempe today and what's being proposed. And you can see in each of the charts that Tempe is either the third or fourth lowest across all of these different usage profiles. And this is against all of their FY22 rates. Many of these agencies will likely have increases in their rates in fiscal year 23, as they're facing many of the same challenges that we are here in Tempe in terms of aging infrastructure, inflation, regulatory requirements, and changes in demand patterns that are affecting our overall ability to meet those requirements. Now, I did mention two programs that were looked at as part of the study. The first was really cataloging the list of various environmental and stormwater activities that are being performed within the water and wastewater enterprise. And so we've identified a number of activities that are currently in the Water and Wastewater Fund, as well as a number of other kind of stormwater and environmental activities within other various city functions outside of the utility. And that's in the gray box there at the bottom. As many folks may be aware in the region, there's been a movement to really separately identify these activities and have a dedicated and transparent funding mechanism for them. So you've seen communities like Gilbert and Peoria and Mesa and Phoenix, Surprise, Scottsdale, and others that are even now considering it as well, creating a dedicated fee to cover the cost of these activities and making sure that we have that in place so that as these requirements change in the future, we have a very transparent way to show what those costs are and a dedicated funding mechanism to address these requirements. And so I think it achieves proportional equity as well as transparency and dedicated funding for some much needed activities. In addition, we also did evaluate the flood irrigation program, looking at the cost of capital as well as operating expenses as compared to the current revenue sources from city parks, as well as from about the 900 or so customers receiving flood irrigation service. In the past rate study, we were looking at a 50% cost recovery program as part of the rate adjustments that were then proposed. In keeping with that, this study looks at endeavoring to achieve that 50% cost recovery program, and to do so would require a series of adjustments, 6% in 23, followed by 5% a year, to gradually increase to that 50% cost recovery level. And so on the chart, for those that do have flood irrigation service, you'd be able to see the semi-annual fee for a half-acre lot or a full-acre lot. The current is identified in blue, and the new fiscal year 23 fee is identified in the kind of the yellowish orangish color. And so I think, you know, as I wrap things up before I turn it back over to Tara here in a moment, you know, it's just important to have a bit of perspective. So we're fortunate to work with communities all over the country, and we routinely run into conversations about what's happening with the infrastructure, what's happening with water supply resources, what we see with inflation, customer demand patterns, increasing regulatory requirements. And it's interesting, you know, we kind of take a step back every now and again and look at the cost of services in one area against another throughout the entire US. And the Southwest has certainly emerging water scarcity and drought challenges and concerns, but fundamentally has been one of the lower cost areas in the United States for water and sewer service. And I think it's important to keep that context in mind, and that we also need to be very thoughtful about going forward, how do we manage these resources that are clearly very finite and very expensive from an infrastructure perspective, and doing so in a way that avoids significant rate spikes or increases to customers. And so I think the city has done a very good job of being cognizant of leveraging available resources when and where possible, with a plan of proactive and modest adjustments to rates to make sure that we're leveraging existing resources, but also keeping cash flows in alignment so that we keep sustainability top of mind from a financial perspective. And that's going to be important to have this map 10 years from now still look very similar in terms of the cost of service in Tempe as compared to other regions throughout the United States. So just a quick recap from a revenue requirements perspective, the system does need about a 5.5% increase in water revenues next year and 2.5% for wastewater. You know, a part of that we would recommend is separately identifying the stormwater and environmental fee activities within the enterprise funds to have more transparency and dedicated funding for those. Again, it doesn't represent new cost or a anything new to the utility, because we're just looking at the utility's cost that are here today for the basis of that fee. And then for flood irrigation, we are recommending some modest rate adjustments to achieve 50% cost recovery for the flood irrigation program. And so with that, maybe before we go to questions, just maybe, Tara, it'd be good to elaborate on the timeline of upcoming events and when these might go into effect.
Thank you, Andy. Yes, so we have done a robust effort of public outreach and talking to council and sustainability commission, as well as neighborhood advisory commission. So we have one more public meeting, and that will be tonight in person at the library, if any of you would like to join. And then we will be meeting with our commercial and industrial customers tomorrow afternoon to discuss their rate structure with them as well. So with that being said, on January 5th, there'll be a public hearing to consider the rate adoption. And if these rates are adopted, they will go into effect on March 1st. So with that, I would like to open it up for questions, if anyone has any questions.
We have one in the chat so far, so we'll lead off with that one if everyone's okay. We have the question, how are you determining the wastewater usage? I have a lot of landscape watering for my home and want to ensure I'm being charged appropriately.
Sure, I'd be happy to start that one off. And then of course, Steve and others can supplement as appropriate. But for single family residential customers within the community, the city has a 70% return flow assumption. So if you had a water usage bill that was say 10,000 gallons, for water use in a month, then 7,000 gallons would be billed for wastewater as a return flow assumption. However, there's a couple of things to consider on that. Number one is that in all cases, there's a 12,000 gallon cap for single family residential customers to make sure that water use above what could be indoor use for maybe some large families, we make sure that we don't apply our prevailing water rates to that, or wastewater rates to that, excuse me.
Okay, and one from Kim. What does the landscaping reference refer to in the first graph?
So the landscaping customer classification, those are for separate potable water only water meters for typically irrigation. So a lot of that happens in city parks or maybe other rights of way areas. So a lot of those accounts are city accounts for irrigation activities.
Did that answer that okay for you, Kim? Did that make sense?
Yes, it does. I just wasn't sure since it wasn't attached to a particular property.
Yeah, multiple property types could have a separate landscape meter, which is why they're separate and standalone.
Gotcha. I do have one more question. I know other cities are doing things like collecting some of that stormwater to percolate into underground aquifers. Do we have anything like that going on with the city?
Yeah, Kim, we are working with the sustainability office with Braden and with community development as well on any new infrastructure coming into the city and looking at programs like that, what we could put in now and then into the future. And that on the one screen with the stormwater fees on there, it shows what is currently coming out of the rates, and then the rest is general fund, and some of that is incorporated in there as well.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And then I don't know if you can see that, but Taria entered a little bit of extra data there regarding that. That is calculated in the January through March billing statements. Anybody else want to raise a hand, or you can unmute yourself? You can type it in the chat. Any questions, any comments? You're a quiet crowd today. So the other place we'd ask you to go is to tempe.gov/forum and enter any comments you have there or any questions.
Okay, I think we have one more, Laura. How are the tiers determined? Sorry.
And another one. Who would like to address the tiers? Tara, you want to do?
Andy can do that.
Andy?
Yeah, I was going to say, I'd be happy to start with the tier discussion. So, you know, there's two questions on the tiers that we have to answer. How much water use do we have in the tiers to establish them? And then also, how are they priced? And so when we looked at establishing the tiers, as I mentioned, we looked at what's happening in your actual billing information and looked at the data points of, you know, typical statistics, 25th, 50th, 75th, and even higher percentiles. But then we also overlaid against that usage profile data. So what are typical water uses per person from initially published surveys and studies? And also based upon an understanding of the property needs in the community for outdoor irrigation, what are the typical property sizes? You know, what are their irrigable areas and how much water do they need to maintain those irrigable areas? And so we combine those two things to really come up with a four-tier system, with a first-tier system really intended to capture the majority of homes' indoor water use. And then the second tier was based on the typical lot size, what is needed to maintain the irrigable area for a typical lot based upon a sampling analysis that was done of properties from a couple of years ago, actually 2 years ago, as a matter of fact. And then the third tier was based upon a larger lot size, actually at the 95th percentile, and sampling of those lots to say how much irrigable area do they have and what sort of water is needed to maintain that irrigable area. And then the fourth tier is for anything above that. That would then be, you know, subject to that top tier rate. So as you proceed through the tiers, we then looked at establishing prices for each tier based upon how much those demands contribute to our system peaks. So how much irrigation or how much demand happens by tier on our maximum day, as well as in our maximum hour, as compared to normal parts of the year. And we use those differences or change in use that happens in each tier to allocate the cost. So that way we have a system that as we make changes about how we size the tiers, the cost will change and will be reallocated consistent with how the usage in that tier impacts our system and contributes to those peak demands that our infrastructure has to be sized to meet. And so it's really a very much a data-driven process, both in terms of how we try to size the tiers using available data sources and industry reference points, but then also attaching it to cost very specifically to make sure we can maintain that proportional equity as part of the process.
Thanks, Andy. We have a comment. I would like to see more going into the green stormwater infrastructure for the future.
Laura, I'd like to stop on that comment for 1 second. Steve, could you please go to slide 16? That's a great question. And this, I know we went through this but this slide right here depicts this, and Steve can talk about this as well, or Andy, but the top blue is what is being in the stormwater fee that we have now that is currently being funded out of the water and wastewater fund. The future considerations, and you can see other general fund departments and sustainability for green stormwater infrastructure, those are currently being funded right now, but out of general fund. So I do want to let people know those aren't items that just aren't being funded. We, the sustainability office did a great job this year working with water and other departments to get some of these items on there so that the city is looking at these and funding these. So I did want to point that out as well.
Excellent. We have another question. When do the billing increases begin?
If they are adopted, that would be March 1st, 2023.
And another one. So the tiers are just overall water users, not at the individual level.
That's correct. Yeah, we don't necessarily have the ability to do individual water tiers or budget-based rates with the systems that we have in place today. So the tiers are based on the overall customer class as a whole for residential customers.
Okay, does anyone else want to ask a question or type it in the chat? Okay, here's another one. It seems residential will take the increase while commercial gets a cost break. Is this correct?
So actually, I don't know that that's necessarily the case. So if you look at the water side, for instance, all customers are seeing an increase in terms of the 5.5% increase in revenue that's needed. You know, the range of increase is anywhere from 1% up to 15%. And you can see commercial goes up at 3.2% and industrial goes up at 6%. Where the change really occurs is on the wastewater side, where we do see for the commercial customers, really that the current rate structure is pretty much at the cost of service within about 0.3%. So most commercial customers will see an increase on the water side. And then it depends on which classification they sit in for the wastewater side in terms of what rate they'll see there. And the wastewater side, I just want to reiterate, this represents the first time in a number of years that we've had the data to be able to better understand customer flow and strength contributions that we're seeing to be able to allocate these costs based upon those current flows and pollutant loadings. And so commercial customers will see a smaller increase is the way I might characterize it, but they're still going to be seeing an increase as will most of the other customer classifications.
Thank you for that. Anyone else? Well, I think we have addressed everything that we currently have in the chat. We can all still stay on here for a little bit if you guys are still thinking about questions or want to type something into the chat, that'd be great. Otherwise, that pretty much concludes what we have to present, and we thank everybody for coming.
Yes, thank you, Lauren. Thank you, everyone. If you'd like to attend in person tonight, we will be again at the library at 7 p.m. this evening. Thank you again. Six p.m. 6 p.m. sorry. at the library. Thank you.